Let's go to Washington, D.C., where Barry W. Lynn is standing by. The W stands for religion, because Barry was the executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State from 1992 to November of 2017. He is an ordained minister, and he's a lawyer, and he's a prominent leader in the religious left, as well as a strong advocate for separation of church and state. He hosts a podcast called Culture Shocks with Barry Lynn, and he had a fantastic episode last week. The guest was, who was your guest? He came on after the woman who wants to unionize sex workers. He was so funny. His hair plugs looked so lush. Who was that guy?
That man was David Feldman, but not the Constitutional Court Justice for Bosnia and Herzegovina, of whom this David Feldman, my guest, was frequently confused.
Yes.
Yes.
So thank you for having me on the show. And
thank you. Thank you for being on the show.
Lot to talk about. I want to talk to you about whether or not pornography is a health hazard. There are people now, respected government leaders, who say that pornography is a public health crisis. And I know that you sat on the Meese Commission back in the 80s when Ronald Reagan and then Attorney General Meese were trying to get Penthouse and Playboy off our shelves out of 7-Eleven, because back then they felt naked pictures of women's boobies were a public health hazard. If you were sitting on that panel now and you were looking at Pornhub, would you still be pro-porn?
Yeah, well, first of all, I watched the Meese Commission, but I would never have been on it, because it was a loony organization with a lot of largely discredited people on it. But I did follow them around the country when I was at the ACLU. I went to all their meetings, and I tried to cause them as much trouble as possible, because as I said to the New York Times, which was actually one of my two quotes of the day in the New York Times, when they set up the commission, I said, "I believe a train marked censorship has just left the station." So now, there
and
was
you
a lot
didn't
of
you testify?
Well, I testified before them, and I bothered them at every portion of their life, because they were. They were incapable of having a serious discussion about pornography. I think there is an important conversation to be had about it, but I don't think they were having it, because they were just too, in the main, with two exceptions, just kind of right-wing hacks. And I knew that going in, and they didn't prove me wrong when they completed their investigation. But pornography has changed a bit. But it was pretty bad then, if bad means how graphic could it get. Now, I do remember once having a discussion in front of a group of journalists, a debate of sorts. One of the people on the other side was Park Dietz, who was a member of the commission, a psychiatrist who had an endless collection of pornography, arguably larger than that. Supposedly held by the Vatican. And then on my side, I had a professor, a constitutional law professor, who wanted to talk about Lady Chatterley's Lover, as if that's the most pornographic thing that was out there. Park Dietz, on the other hand, showed the journalists an endless collection of genital mutilation slides, just to show them what pornography was in his judgment. There's a lot of porn. There's a lot of porn. It comes in different stripes and colors and flavors and all of that. But I think, to be honest, we have to talk about everything. And you have to say, is there some line you can draw that could be the subject of censorship? And my answer to that is, outside of unwilling participants like children, no. If you've got willing people able and willing to make pornographic images, then they have a right under our First Amendment to make it, to see it, to show it, to publish it.
but keep it out of our schools.
Yeah, we should. I do think within limits, it's a good idea, of course, to keep pornography away from minors because they shouldn't see it. But I don't think we can reduce the entire adult population of the country to seeing only those things that are acceptable for viewing by children. And that, unfortunately, is the way so many of these efforts to regulate sexually explicit material end up going. Think of the children. They can't see this, therefore no one should be able to see it. That's the heart of censorship, and that's the heart of what's wrong with the idea that there's somehow a way to curtail all these images just out of a fear that they might be seen by children.
Does a community have the right to zone where and when they want their citizens to view pornography? For example, billboards. If you live in a city where there are families, is it appropriate to have billboards on taxis and on the highway advertising strip clubs that objectify women?
Well, as a matter of fact, it is, because advertising is also protected by the First Amendment. And in the same way that there are people who would like to take those ads off of the taxi cabs in New York City to advertise strip clubs, it's also true they would like in the past to have found a way to get rid of advertising for beer, for wine, for cigarettes, for all these things. And my premise is, and it was during the time of the ACLU, and it is today, if you have a legal product to sell, then you have the right to advertise its availability. This doesn't mean you can sell it to everyone. You obviously shouldn't sell beer to 17-year-olds or to Brett Kavanaugh at any point in his life, but you can offer it for sale for people who can legitimately purchase it. It's the same with marijuana. If it's legal, I'm not a big fan. I've never used marijuana ever. But if people want to use it and it is legal, then you should be able to do, as you've probably noticed, John Boehner is now advertising how you can become a millionaire by going into the marijuana business.
Right.
Yeah.
Let me get back to zoning and aesthetics. If you live in a town, the city council can decide that we don't want a skyscraper. It's unseemly.
Yeah, that's true.
Right. And they can also say we don't want a Walmart because it's going to take business away from the local stores and destroy Main Street. They're allowed to say that.
I'm not sure they are allowed to say that.
I'm pretty sure a city council can vote not to give a permit to a big box store to protect the local businesses. I'm pretty sure they can. In fact, they did in Washington, D.C. and New York. Walmart has not been able to crack Washington, D.C. until recently, and they haven't been able to crack New York City. So cities are well within their rights to zone certain types of businesses away from them.
Well, you can regulate on the basis of the size in the same way that you can regulate the height of a building. In Washington, they did, of course, recently allow Walmarts. There's several of them now. There's a third one coming open this summer, very close to where I live. So yes, but if it's content neutral, in other words, if you said, you know, you can build the biggest grocery store imaginable unless it's Walmart and it also sells shoes and magazines and CDs, then you can't buy it. You can't regulate the content. That's the difference between what's on a billboard, which is content-based, and what's the shape of a building or the height of a building. But I think in general, zoning is acceptable. It's a good idea. It protects the integrity of communities. But when it comes down to censoring it or restricting its placement just on the basis of the content of what it sells or the content of the image that's on the top of the taxi cab or on the side of the bus, that's where governments, in my judgment, have no right to make those kinds of judgments based on morals, religion, aesthetics, or anything else they come up with.
Okay, this is true. I actually did this. My kids went to a public school in Los Angeles. Clear Channel has a billboard division, and there was a billboard right over my kids' elementary school that was advertising a gentleman's club. I felt it was inappropriate. Now, nobody loves pornography more than I do.
Okay.
Nobody loves strippers more than I do. And nobody loves objectifying women and just seeing them as nothing more than sexual objects than I do. But I felt that children, it was aesthetically unseemly to drop my kids off beneath a billboard advertising a gentleman's club. And I called Clear Channel and they took it down. Was I wrong?
Presumably you were not on the Los Angeles City Council, although possibly you should have been, but you weren't. You're not a government official. If you go to someone and say, you know, this bothers me, I wish you didn't sell this magazine because I don't like it, that's okay. That's called the exercise of your First Amendment right. That's what you did. Clear Channel said, Feldman, he could be a judge someday. We better do what he says. But you didn't you did not pressure him. You did not pressure Clear Channel. You did not threaten Clear Channel with legal action. You didn't try to get a petition to the City Council of Los Angeles to take it down. You asked, and you were given something on the basis of the quality of your arguments. That's okay. That's different than when a bunch of grandstanders at some local city council decide they're going to do something like, in the case of Arizona, now
and
trying
Kansas.
To be the
Kansas.
Yeah, and 12. Well, there are 11 states that now have declared pornography to be a health hazard, and Arizona is about hair's breadth away from doing the same thing. But if you don't do that, if you're not trying to get the government to step in, you're trying to have a conversation. It's the same way as if you see your neighbor is about to paint her or his house chartreuse and you hate that color, you could say, I really wish you wouldn't do that. But if the person says, you know, Feldman, I never liked you anyway. I'm going to paint it chartreuse now that I know you don't like it. There's nothing you could do about it.
Okay.
And there's nothing you should do about it.
All right. Larry Flint, a great American.
I know him.
I think he's a great American.
I'll tell him next time I see him.
Thank you. What happens if he decides to advertise the Hustler Club with a billboard that shows a naked woman on a big billboard?
Well, if it's fully naked, a fully naked person, they could run into issues, not because that's a great thing to do, but that's because that's the way the law is. The law treats certain public displays differently. If they are not obscene, then you can regulate them out of existence, says the law. But you can't do that if it's indecent. This is why you can't say certain words on radio and television, because of an indecency standard. People say, well, what's the difference between indecency and obscenity? Indecency encompasses a large number of other words and images that would not be legally obscene, would not have to pass the test for what is an obscene. A book, movie, video, film. Indecency standards.
What is wrong with advertising a gentleman's club that features raw breasts?
I'm not here to tell you it's a good idea to do that. I'm just here to tell you, you could, in fact, regulate it under this standard that is lower than obscenity, and it's called indecency. But indecency, I remember being on the Today Show once, talking about indecency on radio. And I was with the general counsel of the Federal Communications Commission at the time under the Reagan administration. And she was all upset because Howard Stern had said some things and they were investigating his language on, he was then on terrestrial, not on satellite radio. And so, and she acted like she was too shocking to even say what he said that they were investigating. And I said to the host, who was, I believe, Katie Couric, I said, you know, Katie, your other guest here doesn't want to talk about what Howard Stern did that was so wrong. And I said, but I will tell you, he had a puppet. He put of lamb chop. Remember lamb chop, the puppet?
Yeah, not Jerry as famous.
As, yeah, not as famous as Triumph the Insult Comic Dog, but a secondarily famous puppet. He put his hand up and says to Robin Quivers, "Is this a boy or a girl?" And then he answers his own question. He says, "You know, I don't feel anything, so I guess it's a girl." That was considered indecent, and they were trying to fine him heavily for that statement.
Let me
address. Is that the end of the life? Is that the end of the world because he told a joke about lamb chop and whether there's anything up there?
Let me tell you what I think about Howard Stern vis-a-vis the Fairness Doctrine and Rush Limbaugh.
All right.
I'm not defending bolderizing the airwaves, but when anything goes, and we saw that in the 80s, they decided, let's let Howard Stern and these other disc jockeys say whatever they want. That coincided with the eradication of the Fairness Doctrine. Let Rush Limbaugh say whatever he wants, and there's no need for anybody to respond to it. Just let anybody say whatever they want. Freedom of speech, freedom of speech. And what happens sometimes is freedom is a slippery slope. That sometimes too much freedom, especially when it comes to speech and especially when it comes to radio and television, when there's no regulation and there's too much freedom, the bullies win out. The people with the most money end up with the most speech. And what we've seen on television and certainly on radio is it's okay to be vulgar and it's okay to be ultra right wing, because right wing politics and vulgarity services the richest 1%.
Mm-hmm.
But God forbid you have a leftist or a liberal on radio. You got rid of the Fairness Doctrine. And so what happened is the bullies and the vulgarians took over. So that's what unregulated speech can lead to. Nobody was protecting my side.
Well, let's see. Where do we begin?
Is that true, though? Isn't that?
No, I don't think it is. The Fairness Doctrine is a very misunderstood idea, and it was misunderstood even by the people who made the otherwise fine movie Vice about Dick Cheney. The arguments made in that movie, similar to what you just made, if we only had the Fairness Doctrine, why Fox News, according to Vice, Fox News would never have been able to get started. The Fairness Doctrine only related to local programming. In other words, if you had a local radio or television station that was involved in discussing some kind of a controversy within the community, it had an obligation to air multiple sides of that controversy. And if it had nothing to do with network television, it had nothing to do with the creation of cable, you could still have had MSNBC,
what about
Fox
Rush Limbaugh?
News.
What about
you
Rush?
You could have Rush Limbaugh. Now the question, let's say Rush Limbaugh happens to be on your local radio station. Could you challenge and say, I demand to have an alternative for 3 hours in the afternoon? No, that would not have worked under the Fairness Doctrine. It wasn't about equal time. It was just covering in some way whatever the controversies were. So if Rush Limbaugh is talking about something that is a local controversy, an immigration crisis or non-crisis on the border in El Paso, for example, you might be able to go in and say, I want to be able to express my viewpoint on some other show, and I want to call in and talk about why immigration is a good thing. That's the most you could do. So this was not a panacea, and it wasn't the reason that the Fox News Channel developed, and it wasn't the reason why Howard Stern is on radio.
The Fairness Doctrine, had it stayed in place, as I understood it, had the Fairness Doctrine not lapsed under Reagan, it would have been impossible to syndicate Rush Limbaugh, because even his national stances had local ramifications, and that you could have blocked back then in the 80s, radio was being monitored by the government. It was being regulated, and they wouldn't have allowed these mass buyouts of all these radio stations by five companies.
Well, that's a different issue, though, because I think I was doing radio back in the 80s, and I think even in the late 70s, and Rush Limbaugh was just getting started, and he was on a local station, that same local station I and my conservative debate partner were on that station. And so this was going on during the time of the Fairness Doctrine. Nothing was blocking. Almost every program on that particular station was conservative, not necessarily as conservative as Rush Limbaugh, although in a few cases more conservative, if that's possible, than Rush Limbaugh. But the Fairness Doctrine had nothing to do with regulating that or telling the owners of that station, you know, you really ought to mix it up more. It didn't have that clout. That was not its purpose.
Okay.
What is a bad idea is when you start to allow the complete buyouts, as you put it, of radio, television, and now even newspapers, so that you find organizations like Clear Channel that have an enormous content control and ownership in every form of media you find in the community. That is a problem. That can be regulated, but it would not have been regulated by the Fairness Doctrine. It would have been regulated by other policies then in place, now effectively gone, about ownership of mass media.
Right. Okay.
And see, I never bought the idea that you didn't have to worry about that because there's so many other kinds of media. When the internet got started, people said, oh, look, now everybody can be a radio broadcaster. Now everyone can be on television. But I don't think that's the measure. It's not whether it's there among tens of thousands of other images and ideas and programs. The question is, does it have anything like the clout of the major radio and television stations? So that shouldn't have changed. The Fairness Doctrine, for what it was worth, frankly, I don't think was worth very much.
Okay,
I don't
can we at least agree that the Justice Departments of our previous presidents should have made sure that newspapers and radio stations couldn't be owned by a handful of...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That should have happened. It should happen now. Obviously, it's not happening now.
Donald Trump was at
yes.
the border on Monday in El Paso saying, keep the immigrants out. Now, as the one of the founders and executive directors of Americans United for Separation of Church and State, you're a minister and a lawyer. I want to ask you, you're a champion of separation of church and state.
Yes.
Trump seems to have the evangelical vote locked up. So I have several questions about this.
Sure.
How big is the evangelical vote? And what did Christ say about immigrants? What is the truly Christian thing to do when it comes to immigrants?
The people who characterize themselves as evangelical Christians and who also have this conservative mindset, all of them don't, but about 21% do. In other words, if you ask the question, what do you think should be the basis of law in the United States, 21% of the people will say biblical truth. That's a huge voting block, and it's particularly powerful in primaries. There's nobody, but most labor unions don't even control 21% of the vote. People who are Unitarians, who are progressive members of the Jewish community, there's no block like that 21%, and that's awfully dissonant. It causes a kind of malformation of the electorate, particularly in primaries, which is why so many of the primary voters go out and they vote for people in the United States Senate who are still there who are you go, who is this person? I've never even heard of this person. And then you realize they got through a Republican primary in a Western or Southern state, and that's all she wrote. And that's all that was necessary, because those people effectively have no counterbalance, even in the general elections. On the question of immigration, I mean, Jesus the Christ, or Jesus, if you don't believe he's the Christ, you could just say Jesus, constantly talked about taking care of strangers, of welcoming the stranger. This is because that, in my view, is the Christian way to approach this. You want people to come into the country. You want a diversity of religious views. You want a diversity of races and colors and creeds. This is exactly the opposite of what Donald Trump and his hardcore so-called Christian supporters believe. They think it's a really good thing, as one of distasteful members of the Christian community who is a big fan of Donald Trump said a few weeks ago, there is a wall around heaven, so why shouldn't there be a wall at the southern border?
These people believe that. If you were to sit
yes,
with
they do.
James Dobson, Ralph Reed,
yep.
The Huckabees, they can point to passages in the New Testament to justify this?
Well, they can point to passages, but then they can also point to something else. And they say that if a leader is the leader of the United States, then he, since we don't have any she's to speak of in leadership except for Nancy Pelosi, but they would say if the president is Donald Trump, that's because God wanted Donald Trump to be in office. And then if you say, wait a minute, I've got something to say to them, what about Barack Obama? Then they would say, well, God wanted Barack Obama to be president too, because he wanted to demonstrate just how dangerous it is to take a person like Barack Obama and make him president of the United States. So it was a test. We made it through, and now we've gotten what God really wants, Donald Trump. Absurd as this sounds, and ridiculous as it is when uttered by Sarah Huckabee Sanders, this is what they believe. Would Ralph Reed believe it? Absolutely. The late Jerry Falwell believe it? Absolutely. Pat Robertson believe it? Pretty much assuredly. This is the way. They can't think of another way to address the issue other than to say God wants Donald Trump to be the president of the United States. And he probably wants him there for another couple of years as well.
So as the executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State, you want to keep God out of the public square. I want to keep God out of the public square. And because you believe that we should not be discussing God, Christ, and religion in the public square, our journalists are not asking the right questions. Don't you think it's time for Acosta from CNN? Don't you think it's time for our White House correspondents in the White House briefing room to ask Sarah Huckabee what she meant when she said, she gave an interview last month saying God voted for Trump? Shouldn't she be held accountable for that? If you're going to lead with religion, when George W. Bush says the greatest philosopher is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Don't reporters have an obligation then to introduce the scriptures into the conversation and fight back and argue religion with them until it's so unseemly politicians stop talking about the Old Testament, the Quran, and the New Testament? Don't the reporters have to ask them about this?
They do have an obligation to do that. And I'm not even sure that everybody who considers herself or himself to be a church-state separation would agree with what I just said. But I think when people make these comments, they are required to address it. But I'll tell you how difficult it is.
And it's difficult because if I were Leslie Stahl,
yes,
I wouldn't wear those shoes. That's a whole other issue. But if I were Leslie Stahl, if I was on 60 Minutes and I had Donald Trump and I asked him about this, if I asked him about his religious beliefs and the things
sure.
he said, it would be considered unseemly. It would be unfair. It's always framed as, oh, I'm going after his religious freedom for asking those questions. So they're free to bring it all up and speak to their religious followers and do dog whistle politics. But when the journalists split hairs with them over their theology, they're bullies. We're the bad guys for bringing this up.
That is sadly the case, but it shouldn't be. And I'll tell you how much it's even worse than this. Whenever there was a nominee for the United States Supreme Court, I always recommend that Democrats on the committee would at least ask this question. When somebody says or is a known Catholic believer, can you separate your religious views from your obligations to the Constitution when you're sitting on the bench? Just to ask that question became so contentious. People, Republicans would jump in and go, oh, you can't ask them about religion. All it was the question, can you segregate from your religious views your obligations as a federal judge on the United States Supreme Court? Just to ask that question was considered shocking, rude. I cannot tell you how many times I remember Bill O'Reilly. I mean, I used to kind of live on Bill O'Reilly's show. And every time I would say that, or every time someone would actually listen to me and ask that question in an open session of the Judiciary Committee, O'Reilly would get apoplectic about it. And but it's crazy to me. Of course you need to ask that. It doesn't matter that, generally speaking, people say, oh, of course I could separate those two parts of my life, and then they don't do it. But to fail to ask the question is irresponsible, even if you think they might not answer the question honestly. But you can't, because to do that, to say that, gets you in enormous hot water as a member of the United States Senate.
Yeah. Well, Barry W. Lynn was the executive director of Americans United for Separation Church and State from 1992 to November of 2017. Besides being an ordained minister of the United Church of Christ and a prominent leader of the religious left, he is also a lawyer and the host of Culture Shocks with Barry Lynn, which you can download on iTunes or your favorite podcast application. He's got an amazing guest this week, David Feldman, who's just absolutely brilliant. Can you stand the line, sir?
Absolutely.